Hi, and welcome to Healthy Living. I'm Debbie Lyons. I am here today with Kelly Presnell, Director of Marketing and Public Relations here at Hilton Head Hospital. And we have a fun show today, really informative.
Right.
We're looking forward to it.
Right.
As we both sort of...
We're on location.
We are,
We're on location,
awesome.
Right. We don't typically veer out of our normal set.
But Field trip.
Field trip, right. We wanted to show off our rehab department. We have such a strong rehab department here at the hospitals. Specialties of pediatrics and adults, comprehensive, physical therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy. So we cover the gamut of rehab services for the area. So Ruth Hyde is going to be here.
Perfect.
She's the director. Yeah. She is a practicing occupational therapist as well. So people may come into contact with her as a therapist. So she's very knowledgeable and supportive of the efforts of the hospital.
And you all have two locations.
Right, Hilton Head Hospital and out at the Bluffton Okotie Outpatient Center for PEDS, and in the hospital for inpatient rehab as patients need to be discharged home from an illness.
This is going to be great. Let's talk to Ms. Ruth.
Great, she's great. Yeah.
Hi, can I get through, please?
Dr. Newman.
You know, there has to be a better way. A way to skip the ER waiting room. Like this lady over here.
All she did was log on to inquicker.com to hold her son's place in line.
Now they can wait at home and skip the ER waiting room. Now, which would you choose? This?
Dr. Joyner.
Or this?
Hold your place online at inquicker.com and skip the ER waiting room.
Ooh, is that hot cocoa?
Oh, help yourself.
Pain. It can be different things for different people. A shoulder that takes you out of the game. A knee that stops you in your tracks. Ready to return to a better you? Hilton Head Hospital is here, right in the Lowcountry, to help heal what hurts. From diagnosis to treatment to full recovery, our fellowship-trained orthopedic specialists are committed to getting you back to your best. Hilton Head Hospital. Extraordinary care, right here at home.
Hi, we are here today with Ruth Hyde, Director of the Outpatient Rehabilitation Services. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's really fun to actually see this fabulous building that you're in and where you do all the rehab. Talk to us a little bit, Ruth, if you will. You are the manager.
The director.
The director. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean, and what kind of services do you actually have here?
Pretty much we cover every age group that there is. So we do pediatrics all the way up to the active adults, and we cover inpatient and outpatient, as well as we have all three disciplines. We have PT, OT, and speech.
Okay, let's go back to the basic kinds of things. Let's talk about those three specialties and what they really mean and what kind of actions they perform, if you will.
So physical therapy tends to be more working on your walk-in, back pain, those kind of things, orthopedic issues. Occupational therapy tends to focus more on the hands and be more to do with activities of daily living.
Yeah, okay.
Being able to get dressed and brush your teeth. And speech, obviously, is speech therapy, but they work on cognition. They work a little bit on communication skills and social settings and those kind of things as well.
How does a person, and when does a person actually come to physical therapy, or what do you call it, just outpatient rehab therapy in general?
Yeah.
Okay, rehab therapy in general.
Well, in the hospital, obviously, you're there because you've come in for some other reason that is traumatic, maybe, or you're having surgery, you had a hip replacement or a knee replacement. And then in outpatient, we tend to see some of the post-ops, obviously, or if you've had a stroke, or any kind of trauma, you know, where you've lost the function of something, whether it's your back or your hand or your neck or something like that. And then in pediatrics, a lot of those children are, you know, we have the autism and then we have the developmental delays. They could be from any range of the spectrum.
There's so much to talk about,
right?
Because you all do so much. Can we break that down a little bit?
Sure.
So you're in the hospital and the treatment interventions or the rehab interventions are directed by the physician, I imagine.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Then do you all come to them?
Right,
when
so the doctor writes an order and then we go to the patient's room
and
work with them in that setting. So our goal in the hospital is obviously it's a little more basic. We're trying to get them out of bed. We're trying to get them to just be able to bathe themselves a little bit. We're trying to get them to where they could go home. safely.
Safety, I'm sure, is a hugely important. Why else are getting up out of bed, those kinds of just basic skills, so important?
Obviously, safety is important, but the longer you lay in bed in a hospital, the more debilitated you get and the longer time you need then to recover. So in our current healthcare system, they're always trying to get you in and out as fast as they can. So it's very important that when you do come and they order therapy that you participate with us.
So that we can get you up and out quicker.
Does
that make a difference if someone is an active and willing participant?
Yeah, absolutely. It makes it so much easier for the therapist and the patient does much better.
But I'm scared.
Yeah. Well, we do. We try and talk you through that, and especially if you're post-op and you've got pain.
Right.
You know,
yes.
we try to make sure you're medicated prior to us coming. So, like we have a new orthopedic, and we have our spine center, and both we work with the nurses real closely to try and make sure that they're pre-medicated before therapy comes, so that the pain is not the limiting factor in your participation.
So it's really multidisciplinary.
Yeah, absolutely.
Does that kind of spinal team or the team put together interventions that? Our protocol that you all follow?
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have a set plan. You know, obviously, some docs prefer you to be seen the first day post-op, and some have you seen the second day.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we do. We work closely with the docs and the nurses, and there's set protocols. Each physician is a little bit different.
But. All right. So, how is working with adults different than, let's say, adolescents or kids?
Well, obviously, your approach can be very different.
Sometimes
with adolescents, it's quite the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's more the approach is different, and then obviously the intervention, what the child is more interested in doing. So especially if we have an orthopedic child, you know, who wants to get back to baseball or soccer or
broke his leg
or tore something and had a meniscal repair, something like that where it's a sports related injury, you're obviously working a little bit more and more the dynamic and, you know, a little bit harder core kind of than if I had an 80-year-old who fractured their hip.
True.
You know.
Okay, but that makes a lot of sense to me. Okay,
yeah.
So we come out of the hospital, and then the doctor writes an order for the outpatient.
Correct.
Is there a standard length of time that people have outpatient care, rehab, or is it strictly according to the person, the age, and the injury?
Unfortunately, it used to be that way. It used to be just according to the patient and the injury. Insurance companies and Medicare have become a little tighter with their guidelines, and so they do restrict us to a certain number of visits,
All right.
which makes it very important for us to do the best that we can with the patient when they're here. And that's one of the things that we do well here at Hilton Head Hospital is because we focus on the quality of the care, and the patients are seen one-on-one in outpatient therapy.
And I think it's important even to reiterate that when you came in and we were talking about it, what sets you all apart, what makes you different? You were like beaming and said it's really the one-on-one quality of care.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's why a lot of the therapists stay here, because they get to do that. They get to give the patient the best outcome possible in the limited time frame that we're being given nowadays.
Is most therapy, and we're talking specifically now, well, I guess all therapy, is it movement, is it mental, is it kind of a combination of passive and, what's the other word?
It's not active.
Active. Mm-hmm. Passive and active, or is it just a combination of everything?
It's a combination of everything, and so much of your outcomes has to do with how you relate to the person to get them to be a part of the whole process.
So it's relationship building.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And tell us about who you have as therapists. You talked about having...
Yeah, we have a couple of our physical therapists are manually certified in two different programs, so that means they're very much the hands-on approach type therapists.
Yeah, what would that look like?
Well, it usually feels.
Okay, it wouldn't look. It would be, okay, that makes
sense.
It's
much more of a feeling kind of input. They do a lot more of the hands-on, so they do a lot more of the mobilizations and manual kind of therapy instead of just kind of sitting on a piece of equipment and... telling you to use that for 5 minutes and then they come back. Yeah.
Lift that.
Yeah. So they tend to do a lot more of the manual kind of approach where they're touching the patients.
Who would need that?
A lot of times different things, but mainly you see a lot of back and neck injuries who benefit greatly from it.
Okay.
But sometimes someone might come in and their knees bother them, but truly it's coming from their back. You know, that they don't realize that, you know, maybe their gait's off and their balance is off a little bit. So a lot of the pain patients do really well with that, or post-op. You know, patients who may have some scar tissue going on in a joint, and they need to have that mobilized a little bit to get better mobility.
It's interesting that you're talking. I have so many questions that it's hard for me to even kind of
keep them in your head.
Right. Well, and stay with a continuum of questions that actually make sense. Because the fact that you mention a pain patient as someone who would come to rehab to therapy is interesting to me.
Yeah.
Chronic pain?
Yeah, people can have chronic pain, and you know the docs are doing their part of it, and sometimes it just has to do with teaching them, you know, better ways to stretch, or maybe looking at their environment, changing their environment, or you know, maybe there is something structurally wrong that you know the therapist can manually fix or assist with.
Is the goal usually of outpatient rehab therapy to get back to previous function,
right,
or are you very clear with the folks about what the specific goals are for them?
It's usually patient guided, and we really focus on that a lot more. Now we give you questionnaires about functionally what you want to be able to do and what you used to be able to do and maybe you can't do. So it's a kind of a mutual thing where the therapist works with the patient to see what it is that you know they really want to do. I could sit there and say, oh, I really think you should do
this. This is what I think you should do.
And they're like, oh, I don't want to
do that.
I don't care if I do that.
Thank you so much.
You know?
So, it's
definitely a joint effort between the two.
Now, I noticed that we've been talking about manipulations. We've been talking about active and passive. I see really other pieces
of equipment.
Yeah, well, like treadmills, balls, bands.
Right.
Can you share with us a little bit about how those may be used in interventions?
So obviously those are used more when you're maybe out of that acute phase of just after your injury, and you really now need to work on strengthening and getting back to the kind of level that you were at before. Your range of motion's good, but you're not as strong as you were. So then we tend to work on the equipment and work on some of the strengthening, give you something to do at home as well.
So the doctor has given us the order. We come in, we begin. Are you constantly sort of shifting that prognosis or shifting, changing the goals, I guess?
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. We have to write the goals, obviously, incremental. So we want to achieve this before we achieve that. We want to make sure, you know, that we keep progressing. If it comes to a point where we're not, then
We need to reevaluate.
Exactly.
Yes.
Maybe we need to change our approach. Maybe the patient needs to change their participation a little bit. Or, you know, sometimes, unfortunately, maybe that's as good as we're going to get right now.
I feel like I've been talking to you most of all about physical therapy. How would occupational therapy, what kinds of things would we be doing specifically with OT?
Well, OT is very much more functional based. I always tell people, like, PT will get you to the bathroom, but OT will show you how to brush your teeth when you get there.
Okay, that's so beautifully said. Okay, no,
we're very much about the functional side of it. So it's if you came in, say you had a stroke and your arm's not moving, we'll work on the arm movement absolutely to try and get that back. And then we're going to work on how to teach you how to bathe yourself, dress yourself, feed yourself. If you have a child, maybe you need to learn how to change their diaper or, you know, feed them or take care of your animals at home. Whatever your daily activities are is what OT works towards.
And is it a function of repetition, habit? Am I rebuilding brain cells? Am I rebuilding motor skills?
Well, that depends on the issue, but in having a stroke, you're definitely trying to rebuild some pathways to back to the brain. So I always feel like a stroke is kind of like you've had a major accident on 95, and now you're trying to find a slip road to get around it.
Makes sense.
To get those pathways to work again.
For people who have had strokes, is it both physical therapy and occupational
sometimes
therapy?
Sometimes it's
and
all
speech.
Three. Yeah, so sometimes it's all three. And that's why we're a full service department, because we offer all three in the same location, which you don't find a lot.
We're going to take a quick break and we're going to come back. Can we talk a little bit about children, some of the services that you offer here for the pediatrics kids? Stay with us. We'll be right back here on Healthy Living.
Hi, can I get through, please?
Dr. Newman.
You know, there has to be a better way. A way to skip the ER waiting room. Like this lady over here. All she did was log on to InQuicker.com to hold her son's place in line. Now they can wait at home and skip the ER waiting room. Now, which would you choose? This?
Dr. Joyner.
Or this? Hold your place online at InQuicker.com and skip the ER waiting room.
Ooh, is that hot cocoa?
Oh, help yourself.
Hilton Head Regional Medical Center is located at 25 Hospital Center Boulevard. When traveling east on William Hilton Parkway, make a left-hand turn on Beach City Road, and the next left, Hospital Center Boulevard, will be located just past the Hilton Head Library.
Coastal Carolina Hospital is located on US 278 at Exit 8 on I-95. Telephone is 843-784-8000, on the web, www.coastalhospital.com.
The vision for Hilton Head Spine Center is very clear. It's to provide world-class spine care to our patients.
Physical therapists were there. They were there holding you up. It's nice.
I just love working with all these patients and their families and getting to know them and helping them on their journey.
My life is definitely better, and I'm glad that I came here at Hilton Head Hospital.
We are back. Again, we're here with Ruth Hyde, who is the director of the Outpatient Rehabilitation Services here at Hilton Head Hospital, and it's really fun talking to you. I think we're getting tremendous insight into what this department, what you all really do here, and it's pretty impressive talking about the three different areas, speech therapy. Help me. Look at her. She's like, come on, you can do it, Jenny. Yeah.
Physical therapy
and occupational therapy. Yes. There I did. I just needed
Good
a
job.
Little prompting here. I'd like to talk. We talked in the first segment a lot about adults. Let's talk a bit about some of the services that you have here for younger people, for the kids.
Yeah. We offer pediatrics both here on the island, and then we have a clinic out in Bluffton, just near Sun City. And both places offer PT, OT, and speech. Mm-hmm. And they see the child from 0 to 18, you know, depending on the child's need.
I was just going to say, let's talk me through 0 to 18. What are some of the specific things that would prompt a parent or a physician to recommend the services? Physical therapy, occupational therapy, and speech therapy. I'm going to keep practicing this.
It depends. It varies a lot. Sometimes there's a definite, you know, something occurs at birth and there's a developmental issue. Other times it's autism that occurs and you kind of gets picked up later as mm-hmm. the child gets a little bit older. But we do offer free screenings for parents. So sometimes.
Oh, screenings?
Right. So sometimes the doc might say, well, he's a little bit behind and maybe the parent, you know, is concerned. They can come and we schedule a free screening for whatever discipline they might need and then the therapist could give them a.
So I would call you and say I've got a child here, and you would set up an appointment. How does that really work and look?
So basically, say you know the parent went to the doc and he said, well, he's okay, he's just on the edge, or
right.
you know maybe he's not articulating correctly, or maybe he's not writing as well mm-hmm. as the other children in his class.
So I didn't realize that you had that
screening. So what the parent could do, sometimes the docs tell them that we will do the mm-hmm. free screenings, but other times just so the parents know that they can come and they just call us and say, you know, I'm concerned about my child, or I'm concerned that they're a little bit behind in this. Or
see, I had no idea. That's really cool. What would a screening actually look like? What kinds of actual techniques or things that you do?
It varies from each discipline.
Okay.
So it depends on what they're looking at.
Usually, it would be all three of our little.
Not necessarily.
Okay.
If they called and you know we feel like they need all three, then yes, all three would sit in together. But a lot of times they would do stuff that's age appropriate, obviously, mm-hmm. just a generalized screening. They're not going to do a full-blown evaluation, mm-hmm. so it takes about 15 minutes or so. Depends on the child. Sometimes they come in and it takes 15 minutes just to
settle them down
in order to do
the screening.
Engage them in the process.
And what happens if the screening says is positive for potential issues? Mm-hmm. Then they go back to the doctor and then recommendations begin?
Right. We have a letter now that we would send out to the physician and say, you know, we did the screening and we feel like they would benefit from, you know, physical therapy, OT, or speech, or whatever it is. And will you please send us a referral? Or the family could follow up as well.
And how often do young people actually come in for treatment?
Now, again, it varies from the age of the child up. Most of our children come about twice a week.
Okay.
The timeline varies. Like some can tolerate an hour, some can tolerate an hour of PT and OT together. Others, like the smaller ones, like your little babies mm-hmm. or whatever, they maybe tolerate 30 minutes of a session. So we kind of try to accommodate the session with the child's need. We do 10-hour days so that we can pick up some of those school-age children before school and after school.
Okay.
It kind of varies on the child and the diagnosis.
If I were to walk upstairs to the pediatric area, what would I see some of the kids doing?
Well, first you see lots of bright colors because we just had it redone and we got bright colors on the carpet. We've hopscotch built in. It's very cool.
Oh, how cool is that?
Yeah, it's very cool. And then we have kind of an open gym area where they do all kinds of things, like from the trampoline to the swings and all those kind of sensory type activities. And
yeah, what's the goal of what would that accomplish from a therapeutic point of view?
For some children, it's important for you to educate the child on how to calm themselves down.
All right, self-soothing.
Yeah, especially if they have a little bit of autism, or just even some of the general kids are just very high-spirited, as people call
them. I like it, high-spirited.
High-spirited. Mm-hmm. I have nieces and nephews
that are high-spirited.
Yes.
Yeah, don't we all?
So, you know, sometimes using those sensory things is to show them how to calm. So we often do the swinging and the, you know, trampoline prior to doing the therapy, where we maybe want to sit them down and have them focus on handwriting, or we're having them focus on articulation. So we kind of have to give and take with children a lot more than you do with adults.
Is it a group setting? Would it look like active play?
It looks like active play, but again, we do one-on-one therapy upstairs as well. We do group when it's appropriate. So, for instance, we do some socialization groups.
Oh,
children
perfect.
Who
Social
are very
skills.
Similar.
Yes.
And we also, some of our therapists go out in the community, like if they want to go to the playground and see how they interact with children in the playground. Our mom says, you know.
Oh, so in the natural environment,
yes,
they'll go, oh, that's
yes.
amazing.
So we do offer that as well. And we'll go to, like, if they want to go to the grocery store, mom has a problem with, you know, them going to the grocery store, or they can't interact there. It depends on where the need is, but yes, we do offer that.
It sounds really holistic. It sounds like you really get to know the kids. And
oh my gosh, yeah. Yeah, the kids are like family. You know, you see them coming in now, and everybody knows them, you know.
Well, it was funny. One of the therapists was walking by before we started. Yeah. She's like, yeah, the kids are upstairs. They're all having a great day.
They're being quiet at the moment.
Yeah, I don't hear any.
Yeah, my office is right next door to the pediatric department, so there are days when not much work gets done in my office because I actually go in to see what's happening, and then I get sucked into the hole.
Oh, I'm sure. And you said screenings. Really, any of us can call in for a screening, but typically our referrals made through the physicians, family docs, or pediatricians?
Yes, pediatricians usually. Or sometimes, you know, they go to a specialist, maybe up in MUSC or some of the local hospitals.
Mm-hmm. And then come down for the follow-up treatment.
Yes.
Is there a typical length of stay?
Again, it's very dependent on diagnosis. We have had children here, like maybe who've had Down syndrome, who are here from
birth till.
Right. You know,
you are part of the family,
right?
Then.
And it becomes you know their family, you know their siblings, you know everybody, you know. And then others, maybe they're here because they have something simple like a torticollis, and you know you just do a lot of stretching, spread out their treatments.
Now, so you can't say that word without explaining to us what that means, right?
A torticollis is when sometimes when the baby's kind of a little squished inside, and when they come out, their neck muscles are a little tight,
right? Mm-hmm. And they can't.
And you just have to kind of work on stretching those out. Yeah, and it's very important, too, because the child has to be, you know, if you think this is your norm, but really this is your norm.
That's true.
You know, it throws your world off a little bit.
I never even thought about that. Is that typical of what you would see? Mm-hmm. And that's just a matter of stretching?
That's one of the ones we see,
And that can't
But that's a short-term kind of one. That's
okay.
why I kind of brought that one up. You wouldn't usually see them for very long.
What about speech therapy, again? Recommended by teachers? Recommended by...
Yeah, and again, by the pediatrician. So maybe it's something simple like an articulation, or maybe they're, you know, severely autistic and they're not really speaking.
Mm-hmm.
And so in those situations, we've started using a lot of what we call augmentative technology.
And I wanted to talk about it now.
Yeah, so what we're trying to do is...
New word, guys, augmentative technology.
So it's trying to find a way of communicating for these children.
All right.
Years ago, we used to just use the pictures, you know, and we'd make little picture boards and they'd go home with their pictures. And now we've...
In order to communicate...
Right, they would point what they wanted. And now, obviously, most people have iPads and iPhones, and there's so many apps out there. So we've kind of gone down that route, and we've gone through lots of different apps, and we find different ones that work for different children.
Give me an example. Pardon me of what that... Well, what would that look like? Would that be...
Oh, different things. Like, there's one out there that, like, if the child picks a mouth, then it'll... When they go to talk, it talks back to them. You know, things to try to engage them in, like a game or an activity. We have other ones that just have the pictures. Like, if they're totally nonverbal, they can just point to the pictures and it says the word for them.
And then would it literally you would develop till eventually you were typing in words? And
no, they never have to do that. They just would push the pictures to get their needs made, you know, because that's a lot of times with these nonverbals is they're so frustrated.
Yeah, they know what they want.
Right.
In their mind, they just can't articulate it.
Right.
I never thought about that.
Mm-hmm. And so there's lots of different things. And we use the iPad, of course, with, you know, OT and everything because of all the different games that, you know, depends on what we're working on with them. But it's nice because it's something that lots of people have at home. And a lot of these apps you can find out there are free. So again, it's easy for them to carry it on at home.
One of the things that's interesting in just walking around and looking at the services that you offer here, and we talked a little bit about treadmills and all kinds of crazy things that you wouldn't think of as being part of an intervention. I noticed you have a great pool.
We do. We have it's pretty much a full-size pool. It used to be a volleyball pool, so we've kind of two shallow ends and the middle is deep.
Like it. Uh-huh.
Yes, and it is always around 89 to 92. is the temperature.
All right.
So it's not for swimming, but it's for therapeutic exercise, basically. So we see a lot of back pain, or sometimes we see the pre-ops, post-op patients, anyone who needs to be in that environment where it kind of offloads some of the weight, you know, from your body.
For what would you need to do that for?
Well, say, you know, you've been debilitated for a long time, or the pain is limiting you from being able to walk long distances. When you go in the pool, the warmth helps, obviously. And then the other thing that helps is, you know, you're now able to strengthen and walk, you know, exercise without doing it on land. So it's easier to do it in the water than it is to do it on land.
I never even thought about that. Mm-hmm. And then they can transfer from...
If, for instance, you had a stroke or something like that, we do have a chairlift, so it's easy for them to get in and out of the pool. They don't have to go up and down the stairs.
Mm-hmm.
But basically, it's to try and strengthen them back to where they can walk on land and take their whole body weight. In the water, they're not having to carry their whole body weight.
See, I never even... That makes a lot of sense to me. What are other things that you would use pool interventions for?
Arthritis is another good one.
How would that?
Because the warmth helps to limber up the joints a little bit.
Okay.
And then you tend to get more range of motion, and again, you're working on resistance and stuff like that without having to do it on land.
Mm-hmm.
And in our pool, as well as in our gym, we also offer like the community program.
Okay, so what does that mean?
If you've come here for therapy, or you just want to come and join our gym and you don't have one where you live, and I know lots of people have them on the island, but some don't.
Yeah, but this is great. Yeah,
right.
You've got good equipment.
Right.
Yes.
So you would come and the therapist would evaluate you. They'd set up a little exercise program for you, and then you come back, you know, whenever you're coming, you pay $5 a visit.
What?
Yeah. That's a great program.
With a therapist that would actually say yes, I think.
So the therapist will be out there, but you're kind of independently
doing
your program.
Yeah, you're independently doing it, but you've got someone
there. But the therapists
are
around,
exactly.
Absolutely. And we do it with the gym as well, so that we have people that come back in, and, you know, if they have a question, then the therapist can help them.
I just think, boy, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's great.
One of the things that I'm interested in is I'm getting older, and I have, you know, parents also who are getting older, is balance is always something that I think about. I watch... You know, I just watch that in myself and them.
And we do a balance screening once a month, and that you go to our call-in center to schedule that.
Okay.
But one of our physical therapists does a basic balance screening with you, and oftentimes he can pick up, yes, you could benefit from therapy, or no, you know what, you're doing well. So sometimes it's a kind of confidence thing, I think, as we get older, especially if you've had a fall, and you begin to be afraid that, you know, you're going to fall again.
It's the fear factor as much as anything.
Right.
But is balance something that I can improve? I mean, not but all of us can
improve.
Absolutely,
and a lot of times it has to do with strategies. Sometimes it has to do with just strength. You know, that maybe you've spent your whole life doing certain things, and you kind of, some of your other muscle groups have gotten weaker over time. Nobody likes to exercise.
No.
But it is good for you for lots of reasons.
I tell you what, this is amazing. I really appreciate you, and it's great to
Thanks
be here and coming. Actually see, you know, the facilities that you have. And we want to thank you all for joining us here on Healthy Living. Have a great day.